He is Dunajewski. Professor Dunajewski. I was the reviewer here. Yeah. I was the reviewer of the doctorate, of the PhD work of that guy.
Uh-huh.
He was American.
Right.
So you see, I have... My parents had three boys. Dobra, that is Henio, the younger one.
Yeah, I figure. And this is Pavel.
This is Pavel. And
so this is you, yeah. I thought it was this is
my you. Parents, especially my mother, wanted that the second child should be a girl.
So that...
But it was me. So look what kind of hair, like a girl.
I know. Okay. Listen, Jerzy, we have to
think. I know, the last picture.
Jerzy Tamala was my dear and close friend for more than 50 years. He faced many difficult times in his long life. But as for most Poles in our generation, none were more perilous than those during World War II. Under the Nazi occupation, 1.5 million Poles were sent to Germany as forced labor. Jerzy was one of them.
And they came and they took you, the Germans took you to Germany.
There were also other people from Bjerunstari where we lived.
Yeah, they took them
who were taken to Germany to work on German farms.
Right. Mm-hmm.
The pictures and narrative in this short film tell his story, the story of one man caught up in the upheaval of that time. But I believe that his escape, survival, and perseverance during the war and afterwards represents much more. For me, it symbolizes the resilience and hope that Poles such as Jerzy have shown throughout history.
You were the only other person besides the family?
I was the only one.
You were working on the farm?
Yes.
And you and the girl were speaking German and they were treating you very well?
I was doing nearly always together with her homework from the gymnasium.
But did they have any other children besides the daughter?
Yes, they had a son who was in the war and he died in Russia.
Did you ever have contact with them after the war?
Never.
Do you remember their names?
I never had contact with them. And now I want to think about it. Why? I don't know. It was a closed history for me. The more that I didn't want to see again Mary, the daughter.
Oh.
Because maybe she was married already, you know.
You went with your friend, the Czech guy.
Yeah.
Who spoke Polish also, yeah?
Of course, fluently Polish and Czech.
What was his name?
Pavel Ryczka.
In late November 1944, Ryczka and Jerzy crossed the Rhine in a small boat that they had found at the edge of the river. They landed in Alsace, which had been French before World War II, but now, in November 1944, it was part of Germany and under attack by the Allies. They made their way to an abandoned Alsatian village whose German name was Niederolm.
I remember, very cold winter. But in Alsace, when the Allied troops were moving towards Germany closer and closer, they have evacuated all German population into Germany. Behind the river Rhine, on the other side.
Right.
All German families. So there were some villages with no population. I was staying with Ryczka, but there were also other Polish people who were working there in Alsace. 5 or 6 weeks, I don't know how long that was.
Jerzy and his companions found many provisions in the village, The German occupants, in their hasty retreat to the other side of the Rhine, had left behind plenty of potatoes, pears, plums, and other food. For the moment, things were quiet in the abandoned village, but the worst was yet to come.
Where did you get the arms?
From German soldiers. When the Allied troops are moving closer and closer, we had guards in the houses which were close to the outlets of the village.
Right.
They should watch that when German soldiers will come, they have to tell us everybody, especially I was chief of that whole. When the first two Germans came, we let them enter the house. And when they entered the house, we captured them. German soldiers, maybe he was 18 years old.
They were young then.
And he asked, "Don't shoot me, don't shoot me." And Richka shot him. We have put this corpse into cellars where we were not in the houses. This is also what I am, Tomie Drenchy.
But you had to survive.
Je to mnie dręczy.
But it was war.
Ale how to say in English?
It pains me.
Yeah, it pains me, it pains me. Woods, Lasse, 2 kilometers from the village. But we didn't know who will be. Canadians, Englishmen, American, French.
As the Allied troops approached, Jerzy and his companions decided to risk everything and to approach the tanks coming out of the forest. They had prepared for this situation by making a red and white Polish flag out of coverlets that they had found on beds in the village.
We all fell down, but it was flying very hard behind us. And then it exploded. So we have risen again. And I know they have risen again. Well, I said, no, keep flying, lying down.
Richka.
And Richka, and you move that flag. And then the tanks came very close, was opened.
The turret.
And American soldiers came out. American officer wanted to get more information about us. I think that the most important reason was that we had arms. Did you come from Poland to Germany? I said, from southern Poland. Tell me the name of the city. I said, Bierun Stary. Aha. How is another city very close to that Bierunsta? And he spoke very nicely, but slowly.
In English?
But slowly.
In English?
In English. All in English. And I said, well, Katowice. Oh, Katowice. He said, I know Katowice.
He said?
Yeah, but in English. I know Katowice. And how come you know Katowice? I know Katowice because my parents took us, I have one older brother and one younger brother, they told us coffee and cake. Yeah? And do you know the name of the coffee shop? I was thinking, now I am thinking, at that time I knew exactly.
Yeah.
Otto, Cafe Otto. I said, well, Cafe Otto. Uh-huh. On which street? I said, Mickiewicza Street. Yes, you're right. Now he speaks Polish. Wiem dobrze, bo ja pochodzę z Katowic.
The American army tried to incorporate these Poles, such as Jerzy and his companions, into their own units to help with displaced persons and prisoners of war. Jerzy spoke Polish, German, and English, and he became the leader of one of those units.
they have planned to organize American-Polish companies, guard companies, so the American soldiers could go home and you would take over, guarding German prisoners, guarding factories we were supposed to, for instance, as jako odszkodowania wojenne, war repairs for Poland or for Russia. So you will get two officers, American, and you will go through the camps. And I was traveling with the American two officers. They had in DP camps, Poles, Czechs,
right,
all kinds. And there were also Polish soldiers liberated from prisoner camp. I was in charge of this company. Commanding officer, APO 807, Supreme Headquarters, LA Expeditionary Forces. George Tomana, sir. Tak się meldowałem mojemu tam. My company was 40 kilometers north. The name was Butzbach. In Butzbach was a very big German factory which was producing parts for the German Air Force. But this factory was for Russia. And I hated Russia already before the war, because our parents were against the Russia, and especially Soviet Union. Mm. Because that was American occupation zone. But I had the authority to write tickets to go to the French and British occupation zone. Because, you know, there are many things which have to be done. The American army, their equipment, tanks,
right,
guns, and it was no business to bring it back to America. Because they have already started to produce modern tanks. And those were too old.
I see.
So they were selling tanks to French army, to Italian army, Belgian, Holland. And from that German factory, which the Russian were supposed to take all this equipment, I have taken the best Tokarka. I took it on the 6x6 truck, written ticket to the French occupation zone, but they went to France and sold it to French farmers. And the whole truck they came back with. Champagne and the American, such eyes. My God, look at the boat. They have French cognacs. I had very good pension from the US Army. 10 times more. I made selling those stuff who was proposed to go to the Soviet Union.
Okay.
I had plenty of money. Sometimes later I have bought a Mercedes, American White Star. And the Americans, my God, look at this Polish guy. The American officer who was supervising our guard company, Lieutenant Colonel Cunningham. And when the war was over, he invited to Germany his family, his wife and his only daughter. And they were living in Frankfurt. And here I was 20. But in their family, everything was decided by her auntie. She was governing the whole life of that factory.
Of
and
family.
She said, what? My beloved Claire should have wedding in that fucking Hitler Germany? When that Polish guy want to marry my great niece, he has to come to Sacramento. I was supposed to go by ship to New York, and in New York, on the day when my ship would arrive, there would be Claire with her auntie.
As head of a logistics unit in charge of dismantling a large factory, Jerzy had many opportunities to travel, especially to Italy and France. In Paris, he had an aunt, his mother's sister, Tina, who had married a Frenchman. He had been trying to locate her, but unsuccessfully. He had no word from anyone in Poland about his family, and he was trying to find out whether they were still alive.
After one big party, we had plenty of whiskey. I was quite well drunk, and suddenly, like somebody would hit me on the head.
You remember that?
Biberua! The name, family name of my daughter. Tania Di Belua. So next day I have written to the
chief of police.
Chief police in Paris. Tania Di Belua, sister of my mother, born in Strzelce Opolskie in Poland. I have got an answer from the police department with the address of my auntie, but it was not the house where she was living, but it was an address of a hotel. So I have written to Tania on that address to that hotel.
Unfortunately, Jerzy never received a letter from his aunt Tina, and so assumed the worst about his family in Poland. But a letter finally arrived.
Your letter was chasing me from one hotel to the other. Because I was moving.
Leaving, you were leaving address.
From one hotel to the other, and the letter went always after me. And it is very good that I didn't receive your letter earlier. Because 2 days ago, before I received your letter, I got a letter from my sister Franciszka living in Bieruń. Your mother is living. Your father is living. Your two brothers are living. Even Pawełek has survived the Auschwitz concentration camp. And on every first Friday of the month is a special mass held in the church because of your death. Because they were thinking I am not living.
By the time that Jerzy found out, in 1946, that his parents were still alive, the communists had consolidated considerable political power in Poland, and they were controlling movement in and out of the country.
In Dziedzice, we had to go and through a special process where they have written down all about us who came. Where have you been? Where have you worked? How long? Mm-hmm. And so on. And where are you going to Poland? To which cities? Went in. He asked your name. I said Jerzy Tomala. Okay, sit down. And he asked me, tell us everything what you have been doing when you were in the U.S. Army. Here I must mention one problem. In my company, we had a very big gas for benzina. And in that company were two very high Polish flag and American flag. And one day drives a car in Polish uniforms, so I knew at once they are Poles. One of them was a woman captain, and they asked me, can you give us some gas? Because the Americans are giving us so little amount. They don't want us to visit the camps. Because I will tell you the truth, we are also trying to convince you that you should go back to Poland.
Right.
But the Americans are not interested in that we should go back to the Soviet Union. She was very nice. And she was trying to convince me to go back to Poland. But I said, it's impossible. I have a fiancé in America. I am going to the United States. But then when I got the letter from my auntie, and she just came the next day. When I received the letter from auntie, the next day she came again. And I told her, my parents are leaving. Maybe I should go back to Poland, and after some times, maybe 4 or 5 days, 1 week, I have to come back because I have a ship going from Hamburg to New York.
Right.
She said, okay.
Okay.
Okay. After that talk with that officer in that special room,
right,
they knew everything about me because the captain, I was thinking, when I will find that, I will cut her throat. So what I tried? I tried to get over the board.
You did?
Yeah, 3 times. Cap. The third time near a Szczecin, they nearly shot me, so I resigned. So I said, well, when I have to stay, I have to go to school. I knew mathematics, physics, biology on such a level like it was on the first studies at the Polish Polytechnics,
right,
Technical University. So I have passed an special examination to the second, the last class of middle school, liceum. When you finish the liceum, you are świadectwo matura. And at the end of September, I was supposed to go to the Polish army for 2 years. But in August, I have met one of my best friends from that secondary school, Adus Franek. And he said, well, I know that you have been in the US Army, that you came back. Very nice to see you again. What are you going to do now? I will be a student.
Right.
And with that, I went to this office, drafting office.
And I showed
them. And I showed them, so I am not going, I am going to study. I said, well, you see, I also wanted to get such as information that I am going to be a student. But I never got one. I tried in Wrocław at the university. I tried in Gliwice and they wouldn't give me.
They wouldn't accept it.
They wouldn't accept me. I was on the blacklist. And therefore, wow, to the army and not study. That guy from this imperialistic US army. So I said, you see, Alush, I have to go to the army. He said, no, you are not going. You have money? Of course. No. Only a little amount of a little bigger amount. No, I said, no, a little bigger. I have a very big amount.
That, where did you have all this money from?
Pardon?
Where did you get all this money? You brought it from Germany.
No, from Germany.
And they didn't take it from you.
No, they didn't. They didn't. They didn't invest all my baggage.
No.
No, nothing like that. I had all the money. I had American occupation dollars. Zaświadczenie. A statement that you will be a student.
You just have to pay for it.
No. Yes, you have. But it is not something like a bad
bribe.
No, it's not bribe. There is one high school in Poland which is private. This private high school.
A university.
Akademia Handlowa. Like University of Economics. And she said, well, when you go downstairs to the cashier and you pay for the first semester,
we'll give you
so tomorrow you can come and you will get a statement that you will be a student.
Right.
So I went down there and I said, okay, I want to pay for the whole year, not for one semester, for two, for the whole year of studies. Oh, That the only exception, everybody pays only for first semester. Why you for two? Because I want to be sure that I wouldn't have to go to the party. Okay. So I went back and said, okay, he is from the cash information that I have paid not for one semester, for the whole year. Nobody has done something like that. Come tomorrow and you will get the statement. Next day I come to the office and I didn't get a paper. I got the student index. It's a book. When you are a student, you get a special student book. And I went prouder to that military office. Look, I am a student. I am not going to the army at the end of September. I went to Poznań and I was studying commercial. So when I finished that 1 year, I like economics. I said, well, why should I lose 1 year? I have passed all examination with very good notes. So I said, well, you would look 2 years, because 1 year you have studied and they are going to lose it. And now 1 year you have not studied in the technical university. So 2 years you are losing. No, you better continue. So I became an economist. And at the end.
Jerzy Tomala went on to teach economics in Poznań. And in 1969, he came to the Nicholas Copernicus University in Torun, where he taught until 2004. He became one of the most respected and beloved members of that university's community. Not surprisingly, Jerzy specialized in writing and teaching about America's capitalist economy. He brought his knowledge and love of Western economics into his classroom at a time when such courses were a rarity in Polish universities. He inspired a generation of young Poles with his courses, and when the political opening finally came in 1989, many of his students used this knowledge to help Poland become one of the most successful economies in the new Europe. And in the early 1990s, Jerzy contributed directly to the Polish economic renaissance. He connected American investors with a great team in Torun to create Torun Pacific. Torun Pacific became Nestle Cereal Partners, now the largest breakfast cereal producer in Eastern Europe. I met Jerzy on his first scholarly visit abroad in early 1967 in Washington, D.C. We liked each other immediately. He reconnected me to the country of my birth, where I had unfortunately lost almost all my family. He became my new Polish family, and he made Torun my new Polish home. Jerzy was a great economist and a great teacher. But for me, he was just a great friend. The most honest, enthusiastic, positive person I have ever known.